Okay, folks.
Upper shade.
Good evening. I'd like to call the February meeting of the Cape Elizabeth Planning Board to order. Before we begin tonight's agenda, there's one thing I'd like to make note of, in passing at any rate. Janet McKay, the chair of the Planning Board's term, was completed at our last public meeting, and she will now not be with us anymore. And I think we all owe her a great debt because of her very able leadership. And speaking for myself at least, I know we are all, and I will be, challenged to measure up to the example she set for us. And going a little further, I think folks will notice that we have some new members on the board. I'll just mention them in passing. Our name tags are all in place, so I think it's official. We have Nancy Masterton, Dave Griffin, and Al McNichol with us to fill out the total of 7 people. With those things being taken care of, the first thing I would like to do is review the minutes of our previous meeting, and if anyone has any comments or corrections, we could take a look at those right now. Yes.
Mr. Acting Chair, you said Janet, who was it?
Janet McKay.
Oh, okay. See, when one leaves the board, one's quickly forgotten. That was my point. On page one, next to the last paragraph, buildings now, I believe that should say tower. The issue with lighting is with respect to the tower, not the building. And on page four, about the middle of the page, paragraph beginning on the wetlands and stormwater runoff, Mr. Emery would suggest. Are the planning board meetings, how are the notes written, in what tense? Is it suggested or?
I don't think we've ever had a
suggest
a policy on any one particular tense.
If one were to go back to the have to use the notes, the planning board notes, as evidence, that would indicate that I would suggest, it doesn't necessarily mean that it was suggested. Is that, am I correct in interpreting that way?
Mm-hmm.
And I think it should be changed to say suggested.
Suggested.
Or suggest. And then there were just other small things that I don't, that don't need to be brought up.
Okay. Are there any other items noticed? There being none, would anyone like to make a motion?
Make a motion to approve the minutes as amended.
Second.
All those in favor, raise their right hand. Okay. To begin tonight's meeting, I would like to make note of the correspondence which has been recorded and included in our packets. We'll begin with a letter from N. Gilbert of Sebago Technics regarding the Town Center project. Second item is a letter from M. Vetterline regarding the Town Center project. The next item is a copy of a proposed subdivision ordinance sidewalk amendment. Our next item was the 1997 Planning Board Activity Report, which summarized the status of all of the applications which were acted on by the board in 1997, which in summary included 19 approved applications and one recommendation to Town Council. Our next item was a copy of zoning news for December 1997. We also received a letter from R. Dana regarding the Town Center project. Another item included for our information is a copy of the MC Associates versus Town of Cape Elizabeth brief. Another item is the zoning news of January 1998. We also had a letter from R. Dana regarding the Town Center project. Another item which we received is a comprehensive plan status report, which summarizes the current progress on all the recommended items in the current comprehensive plan, copies of which are available at the Town Planner's Office. And our final item was the Planning Commissioner's Journal, issue of Winter 98. Our first item of business will be election of officers for 1998. If they would like to be assigned, anybody would have some discussion on that. Yes, Mr. Emery.
I would like to nominate Mark Wilcox as chair and Peter Cotter, I'm sorry, as vice chair.
Second.
Any discussion? There being no discussion, all those in favor of approving the slate of officers for this year, please raise your right hand. It's unanimous. Moving on to actual business. Our first item for this evening will be a discussion of the addressing ordinance. This is a proposed ordinance. We have been forwarded a copy from the Town Council and asked to review the ordinance. And we are then have been requested to furnish comment back to Town Council regarding our review of the new ordinance. And this is related, this is going to be a part of, and we're also going to look at an amendment to the subdivision ordinance, which will then also relate to addressing in the town, which will be under the subdivision ordinance section 19-10-3. As background information, I guess it might be appropriate at this time for the town planner to just say a few words about what this is all about.
The addressing ordinance is part of the town's effort to get involved in the enhanced 911 system that is being proposed by the state. There's a committee that's been appointed by the manager, including the fire chief, the police chief, and the town assessor. And one of the first things they're looking to do is put in place a legal document like an addressing ordinance that will help them give them authority over assigning addresses. In particular, they're looking to implement the requirements of the state E911 system, where every building will have a distinct physical address. That means that streets basically are not, you're not supposed to have streets that have the same sounding names, and also you want to have odd numbers and even numbers on opposite sides of the street, and you want to have each individual structure have its own distinct number. So this ordinance generally is supposed to convey authority for that addressing function to the police chief, with the addressing officer designated as the town assessor. The planning board discussed this at a workshop in January and had several comments, and what is included in your package hopefully this evening is a draft that I attempted to summarize what your comments were. In addition, this ordinance is basically based on the town's on the model ordinance from the state. They had some provisions in here that related to subdivision development. It was suggested that instead of putting it in this ordinance, it would more appropriately be placed in the subdivision ordinance. So the other piece of this is an amendment to the subdivision ordinance, which the planning board reviewed at the January workshop. Some revisions were requested, and there is also, hopefully, in your package, a draft, revised draft, for revisions to the subdivision ordinance. Procedurally, the council has asked for comments on the addressing ordinance. And at any time, you can send those comments back. I think there's a deadline within a month of now which they would like to get this back. The subdivision ordinance, the procedure is slightly different. Because it's an amendment to a current ordinance, the procedure is that you must schedule a public hearing for the subdivision ordinance amendment before you can forward it to the council. Any questions?
for information purposes, I think if nothing else, I think tonight it might be a good idea for us to at least sort of recognize the categories that we've already established, and at least for public information purposes from our draft memorandum. And if I could just take a few minutes to go through these, if anyone else would like to offer insights, I think it would be, this is something that's a little more informal and not really an application. We could have this more as sort of a loose discussion. At our workshop, we broke down our reactions to the proposed ordinance into 8 categories, the first of which was that this represents a public safety issue. I think that is probably, and we put that as number one with deliberate consideration, recognizing that areas of the town where numbering or naming are unclear, that the proposed ordinance would improve that situation. The second consideration which we recognized was that as we forward our recommendation to the council, that we should emphasize that if at all possible, the conversion should be done with minimal disruption. It was a concern that several members of the board expressed, that it should not be something that really causes major disruption and problems with regards to numbering and wherever possible. Our third category that we expressed interest in was that there be a statement of need developed in order to present that information to town council, which would have to do with any cases that have been heard or found out about that, or experience where there has been a delay in response time by public services because of confusion about addresses would be interesting to bring to the attention of the town council as being sort of part of the underpinnings of this effort. A fourth concern which the board noted was that new development should occur so that the names and the names of new streets and new subdivisions are clearly different from other areas that already exist in town. And this is an area that would help at a very basic level of sort of people knowing where streets are in town. There'd be no confusion about which Applewood we were referring to or whatever. Our fifth concern was that we supported the concept of having all the odd numbers on one side of the street and all the even numbers on the other side of the street, and that we do not support changing the numbers and reversing them from their current condition if at all possible. This sort of reflects the minimal disruption principle that we spoke of before. Our sixth concern was that had to do with street naming, and that we supported naming private roads so that they have names and not just locations, that having distinct names even for private roads would then enable them to be located also. Our seventh concern was one where we were concerned with what the process would be in carrying the E911 concept into condominium projects. And we recommended that there be some sort of a rational numbering scheme that would be undertaken, but that would not necessarily have to follow the odd-even principle, because many times in condominium developments you don't actually have streets with odd-numbered houses on one side and even on the other. Our final consideration, which we thought would be good to consider, would be the case of numbering across town lines. And we were hoping that we could have some consensus on this. We opposed Section 22-51E, which required street numbering to be continuous across town lines. If that were implemented, the first homes on Route 77 in Cape Elizabeth would start in the 1,000 range, and we would hope that there would be a better way of implementing numbers rather than have them be continuous from other towns. If any board members would like to offer better insights into these, that would be useful to consider at the same, as we draft this recommendation to the council, I think a general discussion would be in order. Yes, Mr. Emery.
Excuse me, Mr. Chair. I don't have any better insights. I just thought under item one, excuse me, public safety issue. I think the way that this has been drafted clearly states the emphasis is not only that our concern is that it's a public safety issue. I think it's also important for the public to understand that it's a public safety, it's a public safety issue, not a planning or zoning issue, which you didn't relay in your description of this paragraph. But I think that's a very important part of forwarding this on to the council.
Mm-hmm. Yes, Nancy.
As you hit the last item, numbering across town lines, it occurred to me that Shore Road, perhaps, the numbering begins on Cottage and proceeds along Shore Road. I mean, you have numbers up in the thousands on Shore Road. I'm not sure. Maybe the planner knows about that. If so, we would have a precedent for numbering beginning in South Portland on Cottage Road and then continuing on to Shore.
1226 Shore Road is the community center.
Right.
Yeah.
The one difference, though, is that the name changes. Mm-hmm.
That's true. But the numbers are still high.
Mm-hmm.
But they're higher at the far end, not at the town line end, right? They're low.
Yeah.
But does that mean with all the vacant land on Shore Road, they've got to renumber things anyway because of the possibility of development on Shore Road?
Well, I think you have a proposal in here that talked about new development, and under number four, you suggested that it was logical to establish a numbering system that takes into account undeveloped lots and potential infill development. So yes, there would there is a strong potential that the 911 committee established by the town would want to make some changes in order to accommodate potential for development on that land.
And that means that the 1226 Shore Road will probably be somewhere in the neighborhood of 2,500 to 2,000 or 3,000?
Well, the question would be if there's been any accommodation for that up until now. And I'm more familiar with the southern part of the town because that's the one I've been working them on the map for. Mm-hmm. I haven't done that part of town yet, but what I would be curious about is whether there was ever any accommodation for that right now, whether there's a big gap in numbers on Shore Road in that area so that we've already saved some numbers. That would be a question that you'd have to look at.
I guess I don't know the numbering well enough either to answer that question. The other thing I had that I wanted to bring up in number six on our street naming, who is going to be in charge of naming roads? And especially on private roads, it seems to me that two or more families live on a private road that they should really have the responsibility or honor of naming their own road as opposed to picking something off a little Rolodex that doesn't sound like something else in the town.
To answer that question, according to the proposed addressing ordinance under Section 22-3-1, this ordinance shall be administered by the addressing coordinator, who shall be the chief of police. The addressing coordinator is authorized to and shall assign road names and numbers to all properties. So the answer to that is the chief of police has the authority to assign names and numbers. The E-911 committee has been discussing a procedure for involving citizens in the street naming process.
I would certainly hope so.
I recall that at our workshop, we discussed the importance of having others involved, and as well as people with, perhaps from the Historic Society, or people with historic knowledge of the town who could help in the sort of creative aspect of coming up with new names.
Well, under number six here, you talk about naming, and we can add some additional statements to that. This doesn't cover it for you. If you want to recommend, I think we talked about the historic links in this, but we didn't mention how important it would be to involve the residents whose names are going to be affected, and we certainly can do that if we want.
I think we should.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a good idea.
And the other thing I think we need to do before this, you know, starts to appear on the scene, you know, sooner rather than later, we should, I think, have an education article or articles published in the Cape Courier that people would read and understand why this is being done, how the system works, and what the possible effects are going to be. And I would really like to have that in the Cape Courier prior to having a public meeting on this, so we could have as many people as possible come and express their concerns. And I think one question that's probably going to come up is each individual property owner or address, if you will, be responsible for all costs associated with having to change a number or a street name, you know, with all their stuff? But that needs to be explained to people. And the other thing that needs to be explained as well, I mean, is this something we absolutely have to do?
The council has agreed to participate in the enhanced 911 program. In order to participate in the program, you have to create a distinguishable, identifiable address for every structure that you expect to have response to. And that doesn't include little sheds and doghouses and things, but every dwelling has to have its own individual address. And they don't want roads that have the same names, because the concern is that in a panic, or if you have a neighbor or a guest staying at your home, they could get the name slightly wrong, and it would delay the response time. So this is the state is saying we have to work out an address system. The 911 committee is forwarding a recommendation of the state, which is to adopt a model ordinance.
Do we have any historical data or evidence to support the fact that this is a good idea for the town? Is the 911 system truly a benefit, or could it actually be a liability in some instances? These are things that residents are going to ask. I think the more information we give them up front, they still have time to think about it and then come to meeting with, you know, more relevant to them type questions.
Didn't we ask for the public safety department to outline the number of calls that the rescue unit makes a year and the number of calls the fire department makes?
In your comments, we've suggested that they should do that. We didn't ask them to do it for this meeting. But under number three, you did did suggest that they provide information.
So that may very well. And, of course, to outline instances in which there has been some confusion about an address. I think if there have been instances of that, then it's important for the public to know.
I have a topic which I would like to offer for discussion, and that would be, should we make a recommendation to town as part of our response, which recommends that there be some sort of workshop approach or stay phased implementation, so that there's some sort of public notice that goes to people rather than just receiving something in the mail from the 911 committee one day saying, congratulations, you're now an odd number instead of an even number, or your street name has changed, or whatever. Should we recommend that there be some opportunity for public comment as this process moves forward? Or should we just rely on the fact that the E911 committee will be entertaining requests from residents?
Well, I think that's why I want so much for this, for a good article to be on the Courier prior to the next meeting, so we can get a lot of people that are going to have questions here. That may eliminate a lot of the questions as the process goes along.
Yeah. The request that we somehow include residents, Mr. Parker's suggestion as part of item number 6 on the street naming, would then sort of apply to the whole process.
I think, the one thing, I feel compelled to say this, we're living in a very small town. It seems to me that I don't think there are that many even close street names. There may be a couple that are sort of close, but one would think that people in the fire department, even though they're volunteers, they're all residents of the town, and the police department. If it's very important for them to know where they're going, I would expect that they would make the effort to know where they're going prior to having to go. And I just have, a little bit of a concern that the bigger computer-generated and whatever system is not necessarily going to be better for the town. So I just want that to be sort of thrown into the mix.
Yes.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to suggest that we recommend to the council that they possibly add some wording in that section 22-3-1 that gives a little better feeling to the members of the town that they would have some input as to the naming of streets, rather than just saying the addressing coordinator is authorized to and shall assign roads, names and numbers of all properties. Being in a small town like this, I think if you look back at the history, you would find that most of the streets and roads that are named in the town are probably named because people are very interested in having that name. I think the people, character of the town, I think we need to, I would suggest that we recommend the council put some wording in that ordinance that will give a little flexibility to the, and make the residents feel as though they have some input. I kind of think that if this comes up to a open forum and discussion, I think that question is going to be raised.
Mr. Chair?
Yes.
I think it's very important. From my own standpoint, having kept a very level-headed, low-key discussion on this in workshop and wanting to continue so, I think it's important that since we're going to be sort of first out of the stall with this one, that it's not misunderstood by the public that we've said this evening, but we're not promulgating this language and we're not instigating the changes. Some of the discussion we had sounded more of a political, more from the political side of things rather than from what would be the normal planning board comments. And I think it's very difficult to separate the two, but I think if we're structuring an article for the newspaper, that the article should state very clearly that this has been recommended to us or forwarded to us from the town council, and the issue regarding our public hearing is for incorporation of certain language into the subdivision ordinance.
Yes.
And it's, although we may hear, you know, sort of the side issues related to this, the public comment won't be, I mean, the council's already decided to hook us into the 911 system, so I, you know, unless someone comes before the council in a public hearing on this particular item, and somehow the council then elects not to proceed with the address changes, I don't believe that's what the public hearing would be under subdivision, the public comment.
Well, actually, it's at the board's discretion. You have to hold a public hearing. If you're going to comply with the procedures for changing an ordinance, subdivision ordinance, you have to hold a public hearing on the subdivision ordinance. It's at your discretion on whether or not you want to include in that public hearing comments on this addressing ordinance as well.
I would really support including it. I'm very interested in hearing it, but I don't want people coming to the planning board meeting thinking that we're going to affect the political process. We're only here for the regulatory side of the issue. But I think most of the items that are spelled out in here that we're passing on to the council deals with that. I think as a question I would have, if I come before the naming committee and someone has a street name, the street I live on is Juniper, someone has a street named Jupiter, in some circles I can imagine that those two names are so similar that somebody would say that one or the other has to change. And from my standpoint, if they're both pronounced clearly, albeit, you know, when you're under a stressful situation, that may be more difficult than it seems, but those are sort of the thresholds that I'm interested in, is to see how things start changing in this. The other example we gave at the workshop was I lived in a community once where there were two Briarcliff roads, and one was spelled I-E-R and the other was I-A-R. Now that clearly is something that could be easily misunderstood, and certainly was, so I would understand something like that. But if we have several Jordan roads in town with different first names, I don't think that that's a reason to eliminate all Jordan roads, but whichever one was the first one.
Yes, Nancy.
Mr. Chairman, may I suggest a wording change in item number 7?
Surely.
The last sentence. There was support for naming streets in condominium projects and requiring clear, and you had numbering. I think it should be clearly visible numbering of individual units.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, Mr.
Would you like to make a motion?
Please do.
Thank you. Motion for the board to consider A, subdivision amendment. Be it ordered that the proposed addressing amendment to the subdivision ordinance be tabled to the regular March 17th, 1998 meeting of the planning board, at which time a public hearing will be held, and B, addressing ordinance. Be it further ordered that the planning board forward the attached comments as amended to the town council regarding the addressing ordinance.
Do I hear a second?
I'd like to second the motion.
Well, could I make a suggestion?
Discussion.
Do we need to, in order to get a public hearing, do we need to repeat that in under the addressing ordinance part of it as well?
I think this is a good point.
I think the planner has a comment that could be very helpful.
Clarification by our planner is very helpful.
When I structured those motions, believe me, they're available for you to change. If you wish to hold a public hearing next month on both the subdivision amendment and the addressing ordinance, accordance, I would suggest you just use a motion A and add "and addressing ordinance," and delete motion B for this month, because if you send it off to the council, then you're done with the addressing ordinance.
Yeah, my input to this discussion was be, do we hold item B?
That was...
Until after we're done with item A.
Right.
Which I would recommend, given the discussion we've had.
I apologize, I misunderstood.
Or add some supplemental language to item B, saying, you know, after item A is completed, it be forwarded to town council next month. Okay, I think that would be good.
Motion for the board to consider subdivision amendment and addressing order? Is that all right? Be it ordered that the proposed addressing amendment and addressing ordinance be tabled to the regular March 17th, 1998 meeting of the planning board, at which time a public hearing shall be held. Addressing amendment to the subdivision, I'm sorry. Subdivision ordinance be tabled to the regular March 17th meeting.
Second.
Any discussion on motion as redrafted? All those in favor, raise your right hand. Unanimous. The final item on our agenda this evening is another review requested by town council. This is a review which has been requested of the planning board in terms of examining its practices relating to citizen participation and public notice. And for an overview on this request, again, I'll turn to Maureen to outline our task.
Every year, the town council sets goals for the year. And one of the goals this year was to review the practice and the provisions for providing public input. And this letter was sent to all the boards and commissions for the town, not just the planning board. But specifically, there have been concerns and questions about the availability of agenda items, opportunity of members of the public to learn of meetings, to learn of agenda items, and to have an opportunity to speak at meetings and participate in the types of decision-making that the various boards conduct and get involved in. What I've done for you is just done a short memo that helps you out with the first three questions, although I think the manager really expected all commissions to discuss this issue in as full a detail as they feel necessary, and these questions were meant to be a jumping-off point and not necessarily a beginning and ending. But there is an agenda prepared in advance for the planning board. The agenda, starting with this meeting, is provided to the town clerk. It's also provided to the town manager's secretary. And the agenda is posted on the internet webpage, and it's also available in the town hall assessing codes planning office. And I'd like to leave you with that.
Okay. I guess at this point, it would be good for us to have a discussion on the final item, which we have had input requested on. And just to sort of give some background information on that, I will read it from the town manager's letter. And it says, "Is the public given an opportunity to speak at all your meetings? May they speak on every agenda item? Do you estimate times on how long each agenda item will take? If a member of the public has a concern that is not on your agenda, do you hear the concern? And if so, at which part of the meeting?" I think this is a topic which does relate to the practices of the planning board. In that we have structured under our enabling statute, if you will, we are structured to have a public meeting once a month and a workshop once a month. And because of the nature of the applications which come forward to us, we are required to hold public hearings on some applications, and on other applications, we're not required to hold public hearings. The work of the planning board consists in review of applications and determining how the ordinances of the town apply to proposed development or work in the town. And therefore, the process which we follow is not one of public information and debate, but rather obtaining information from our applicants. That being said, we very often do go further and require that public hearings be held when they're not required to be held by the ordinance. And I think a general discussion about when we do this might be illuminating. Furthermore, I think a little bit of discussion about our workshop hearings might be appropriate. As most people are aware, our workshops are informal, off-the-record meetings where applicants are given the opportunity to informally discuss their applications, and through an informal exchange of ideas, find out what some of the concerns are that the planning board would have if such an application were brought to the board. They are not actual deliberation sessions by the board, and at our workshops we do not receive public comment in the form of commentary provided at the meeting itself, largely because it's an informal meeting without official transcription of notes and actually, you know, a public record of an actual submitted application. And that being said, we always invite public comment, even at workshops, in the form of written comment forwarded to the town planner, which then become part of the official public record of any application. There are advantages and disadvantages, and I guess in each case I'd be interested in hearing board members' opinions of how well our system works. Mr. Emery.
I think this discussion should fall consistently with discussions that we had a year or more ago about customer service. And I think where a public hearing is warranted because it's required in the ordinance, clearly we have to meet that requirement. The other requirement that we normally meet is if we have a particularly contentious issue under site plan review, then we normally would provide a formal public hearing opportunity for the general public to come forward and comment. We've even, on some issues where a public hearing wasn't required, have elected to hold a public hearing, although there wasn't a lot of public correspondence or indication that the public would be at the hearing. The issue was important enough to the planning board that it wanted to provide an opportunity for the public to speak. On the other hand, I think it's important for the public to understand that in terms of private applications before the board and public applications before the board, it's a very expensive process, and that timely review and approval and disapproval of the project is very important. So I wouldn't necessarily favor holding public hearings for the fun of holding public hearings. I think there has to be a demonstrated need and purpose. In terms of the workshop, we had a lengthy discussion at our last workshop as to whether or not the public should be afforded the opportunity. One of the issues certainly seemed to be if the public's invited to a meeting and has to sit on their hands and is unable to speak, then the public may ask, why are we at the meeting? But I think it's really important to reinforce that The purpose of inviting the public to the workshop was so they could learn about the project at the same time the planning board does. And that would prepare them, if they had concerns or were looking to supporting the project, to prepare for the formal application. It's not necessarily so that an application would even proceed after workshop. One might come into a workshop meeting, decide not to continue with an application. But I think by not, the other way we've stated that is that the workshop meeting is a learning session for the planning board, and it's not a forum for public debate, just as a public hearing is, and it's a forum for presenting information. But anything that gets closer to taking that planning board meeting and making it a formal meeting, either by having to bring it in this room, by having it recorded and minutes kept by our secretary, I think really defeats the purpose of the workshop meeting. And I think would only end up in either having two formal sessions a month, which I won't even begin to support, or just having a formal session and no workshops. But having been on the other side of the table many, many times, the ability to go into a meeting with no television lights, no recording, and just sit across the table from the planning board in a very informal discussion, I think makes it a very good process, not only for the planning board, but for the applicants. And occasionally for all of us, I think it's important to sit and listen. And I think in many cases, certainly in my own case, sometimes we get so pent up with wanting to express our own concerns that we don't listen very well. And by being forced or being asked not to comment during that workshop session, that allows everyone to sit and learn the facts of the case as they're known at that time. A concern I have with a lot of the correspondence we get, I've seen it coming in on the town center now, is that people are commenting on issues that aren't relevant to the a specific project or to the ordinance. And I think in many cases, if the public becomes familiar with the ordinances or the particular area of the ordinance under which a project is being presented to the planning board, it would help them with any, either in supporting the project or not supporting the project. And perhaps that's something that would be helpful to bring out during the workshop session. But a workshop is workshop, and I don't think any stretch of the imagination it should be anything other than that.
Yes.
Are we going right down the row here?
Yeah, no.
I've been on a lot of governmental boards, some appointed, some elected, and most of them have featured some time during a meeting in which the public can be heard. I can't agree more that a workshop is very important for the planning board to understand the facts of an application that is before the planning board. But I also think it's very important for the public to understand the facts, and that if the public bothers to come to a workshop when an applicant is putting forward his presentation and answering questions from the planning board, that it's also a good time for the public to sit and learn and possibly to have questions of their own to ask. Now, by no means do I think that the learning process for the planning board should be disrupted by comments from the audience, but on the other hand, I think that the audience should be, the concerned citizens are the audience, should be allowed a certain amount of time to ask questions of their own, not to express their opinions or their points of view, but to ask questions to the developer, and this would give the public a feeling of participation, and it might, in the long run, save a lot of ignorance and misunderstanding on the project at hand. So I think I understand that public participation can be annoying and troublesome at times, but I think in the long run, it's worth it, and it can be controlled in terms of time, say 15 minutes for the public to question an applicant. I really think that they should learn at the very beginning of the meeting that what this meeting is for, and that their opportunity to ask questions themselves will be at the end of the planning board's consideration for 15 minutes, say. So I feel very strongly about that, and on the other hand, I don't want the planning board's work to be disrupted either, so, but I would err on the side of public participation.
Mr. Parkhurst?
I don't generally like to disagree with people, but it seems to me that the applicant is coming before a workshop to test the waters, to familiarize the planning board with the project, and sort of run things up a flagpole to see what the concerns are of the planning board, because we are the people who are going to be voting on whether or not the project is approved or not. It is not a formal application, and I think a lot of times after a workshop meeting, an applicant will revise something he or she was going to do, or maybe will delete something or add something that seems to be a major concern to the members of the planning board. For that reason, I really feel that the public participation at the workshop level is totally inappropriate, because then all of a sudden, there's citizens who are not as comfortable with the ordinances as the planning board is, that are asking questions that maybe are either inappropriate or are, you know, three steps down the road when the project is actually an application. So I feel very strongly, I like public participation at a public meeting, but I don't think it's productive at a private workshop, not private, excuse me, a workshop where we don't record the minutes.
Mr. Chairman, I know I've already had my opportunity, but I've heard two things with both Nancy and Steve. The way they're talking, it sounds like the workshop isn't public participation unless the public speaks. Just to put everything in perspective, there was a time when the public was not invited to workshops. The workshops were held, planning board met with the applicant, and if somebody found out about a meeting, they went to the meeting. And all meetings are open to the public in Cape Elizabeth, so no one was ever asked to leave. Now the public is invited to the meetings. They're notified, the abutters are notified of the workshop meeting. So because they are unable to speak, it should not be misunderstood that it's not a public process and it doesn't involve public input.
I guess what might be helpful at this point in time, you've alluded to something that I think I'm not quite as up to speed on myself even, and that is, what is the public noticing provisions which we do, and I think Maureen could help us out a little bit here on what the differences are perhaps between noticing for our regular public hearings or public meetings versus our workshop meetings.
I'd like to go back to the Land Use Regulation Process Review Committee that Tom was a member of, and one of the goals of that committee, I think it was 4 years ago, was to look at the town's land use regulation processes and find ways to streamline those processes whenever possible. Several recommendations came out of that committee, and one of the recommendations was that the public needs to be notified more earlier about planning board projects. And the committee strongly recommended that planning board start sending out notices of workshops. Prior to that, our noticing provision is that all meetings are open to the public. We do hold a meeting on a regular date every month. The meeting is listed in the newspaper, so it is a public meeting, and we have agendas that are available in the planning office. if it was a regular meeting, and I refer to a regular meeting as the meeting that's held the third Tuesday of the month, like this evening in this chamber with the lights going, we would send a notice to everyone within 500 feet or the nearest 25 properties. The notice would go out the first time the item appeared on the regular planning board agenda. It would also go out if the board scheduled a public hearing. So for a project that you met six or seven times on, you would get a notice the very first time it went in the agenda, and you would get another notice if the planning board scheduled a public hearing. And the idea would be that if you were interested, you would keep track of the other meetings. After the land use regulation process review committee recommendation, what we started doing is also sending out notices for workshops. And we send a notice out for every workshop for every item. So for example, if a project's gone to the planning board three times in workshop, the abutters have received three notices. And then they would get another notice when it moves to a regular meeting, and there would be a fifth notice if there was a public hearing scheduled. Just to let you know, the notice specifically does say that the planning board generally does not receive public comment at the meeting. However, written comments are encouraged and are received, and it is very common for the board to have one or several letters sitting on the desk waiting for them when they come to the workshop meeting. So there is opportunity for comment. It just has to be in writing before the meeting.
Thank you. Other? Yes.
Note there's a very different geography to the workshops than there is to this session here tonight, to the public session. In the workshops, we sit around a table, and we're communicating back and forth, looking at plans or what have you, and listening to a single witness. It's not really conducive to different members of the audience standing or making a presentation, because they would be making a presentation to some backs. That is, some of us would be back to them. Whereas in this situation here, we're all facing the same direction, and the public has a perfect opportunity to be heard. I would have to agree with Mr. O'Meara that letters could form a significant input from the public, but that the public participation, allowing them 15 minutes on an issue or per person, would only duplicate what we're doing here in public session. I'd be opposed to it. Thank you.
Thanks. Yes, Peter.
I have a question of the town planner. When correspondence is received by your office, Maureen, in regards to a specific application, and that correspondence asks a question or voices a substantial concern, is that correspondence forwarded to the applicant?
All correspondence relating to a project is forwarded to the applicant. Ms. McKay taught me that.
In a sense, that's a public forum in itself.
Right. We keep copies of all the originals of all the correspondence are supposed to be kept in the file, so anyone coming to the office would automatically get the file so they can see all the correspondence that's been written as well as anything that the applicant has submitted. Although for the workshop, there's nothing that the applicant has submitted. The only thing that's in there basically is the list of people who have received a notice.
I think one of the comments we should make at workshops now when we discuss the forum that we use, that the correspondence submitted by the public is forwarded to each member of the planning board, which we state now, but it's also forwarded to the applicant so that they're aware that they have an opportunity to ask questions of the applicant in that manner.
Mr. Parker.
Sort of one last comment here. I think applicants who have been before the planning board prior to their first, well, let me back up here. If someone has come before us a couple of times in a workshop session, I think they feel very comfortable with the process, knowing that it's just going to be the planning board asking them questions. It's not going to be the proposed neighbors of a particular project or whatever asking them questions with very, very pointed self-interest type of questions. and it'll end up making the applicant really not want to come to the workshop and not wanting to get the feedback from the planning board. And I think we'll probably end up seeing less applicants taking advantage of that situation and probably making formal application instead of having to go through sort of an uncomfortable question and answer period. So I think it might have a bad effect on the whole process, actually. And the public is there so they can listen, and then they can address questions to the town planner. And I think it should be, I shouldn't think it should be left that way myself.
An item that I would like to express some concern that I have is that the workshop forms, I'm not sure how many people are aware of the exact job we do, but the workshop serves as a time when, in the myriad of requirements that are in the zoning ordinance that deal with land use in the town, the board needs time to consider which ones apply to a given project, and the applicants also need the chance to find out which ones apply to a given project. A homeowner with a small project such as a driveway crossing a wetland and a large development obviously represent two extremes, but the principle is the same, I think, in terms of not entertaining substantive decision making or even usually discussion about merits and approval or disapproval of projects, but more in order to enter into an application, in order to become, to have standing and be reviewed by this town, you know, how far do you have to go? How many hoops do you have to jump through? And when Mr. Emery mentioned the words customer service, I think that's something that the board tries to do in workshop is to sort of determine, is to give a service to the applicant by helping them determine how extensive a package they have to put together in order to receive official consideration by the town. And those issues really are totally apart from the contextual issues and the likes or dislikes of a project. So I think being able to have an informal exchange of ideas in terms of not necessarily ideas about a given project, but ideas about what this regulatory process is and what we would be looking for is something that benefits both applicants and the town by sort of, if you will, streamlining or speeding up the process without becoming something where sort of pluses or minuses are determined, you know, out of the sight of the public and the television cameras. And I think for that purpose, having the more informal workshop without formal public comment works very well. However, that being said, I think we've discussed the workshop fairly well. What about at our public meetings when we have an audience and not every application is required by ordinance to have a public hearing? Are there any feelings or any thoughts by board members as to the appropriateness of public comment at public meetings? You know, we as a general rule, just if we see public comment forming in the written process after something has been made known that it's an application through workshop, we usually err on the side of being conservative and scheduling public hearings, even though it means an additional month in an applicant's application process. But in addition to that, does anybody have any feelings about just sort of general public comment at public meetings. Yes, Mr. Parker?
I get the feeling that if we had a, just a general public question and answer period or something, public comment period at the end of each meeting for 15 minutes or something like that, I think the members of the public would construe that as to mean that this would be an opportunity to go and try to influence somehow the planning board's way of doing what it's doing. And let's face it, we're guided by ordinances, not by sentiment. And I think it would have the adverse effect of turning the planning board into more of a political board, even though we can't be. I have absolutely no objection, in fact, welcome. It's very interesting to listen to public comment on a specific project, but I think it was just a general period of comment or questions, what have you. I don't think it would be appropriate.
Any other?
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
Of course, I'm on the other side of that. I do feel, particularly at a public meeting, not I feel the same way about a workshop, but particularly at a public meeting, that it is appropriate for time to be set aside for the public with any concerns that they have. Doesn't need to be about the particular application that you're talking about or any other. If there were people here tonight, I'd like to hear what they had to say about their participation in a meeting or the street addressing, the addressing problem. I think it's very appropriate at a public meeting to set aside a brief period of time where the public understands they have to be brief for concerns to be brought up to the planning board.
Mr. Emery.
I think Steve's comments were right in line. This is a regulatory board, not a political board. And in all fairness to the applicants, in all legal fairness to the town, which ultimately could see many lawsuits out of a process like this, if I come in and make a, if an applicant comes before the board and makes a one-hour presentation at a full public hearing on a 500-unit subdivision, the application gets tabled, the applicant leaves the room at 10:30 at night, and at 10:45, four people walk up and express concerns about this ordinance, that ordinance. There's every reason to believe that that type of information would be prejudicial to the planning board's decisions, and probably even more of a concern is the planning board making comments that are not directly related to an application that's before the board. If we respond to a, say, a citizen from South Portland that's concerned about a project that's abutting South Portland, and comes in and starts making a bunch of comments, it's very difficult, I think, for the board to simply sit here and listen without responding in some way. And I think it's important that people who are coming before regulatory boards have some stake or standing in that board. Otherwise, there's a political process that if there's concerns about the ordinances, that can certainly be raised by a letter to Maureen. I'm not sure that it isn't appropriate for a citizen or concerned citizens to call up Maureen and come before us in workshop session, and even though they're not an applicant as such, or through Maureen, relay information about concern for various ordinances. But we're enforcing the ordinances that are already in place. We're not creating ordinances. That's really the town council's responsibility. I've seen in enough public hearings where people will stand up in the middle of a room, in the middle of a public hearing, and make wild, outrageous comments that have nothing to do with either the process, the project, but will set just a ripple effect through the room and get the press involved. There's no stake. They disappear, and it's smoke and mirrors is what we call it in the business. That can happen enough within a formal public hearing. I think when you have informal public hearings at a fully public meeting like that, without the applicant there to have an opportunity to respond and an opportunity for any planning board member to make an out-of-context remark, that's just going to set up the applicant's attorney. I mean, that alarm will go off that quickly, and there'll be protest to almost any non-supportive vote that we come to with that application. This board pretty much deals with business. It's not a board where people can come in and I think we have staff and we have town councilors, we have a town manager. When people want to come in and discuss concerns about the ordinances, that's the forum to do it. Or if there's a particular issue with a project, then they can come forward in a formal public hearing or listen to the workshop. But informal discussion in this format is, I think, something to be very concerned about.
Mr. Chairman, I was just going to further that discussion. I think Tom's on the right course, because I think there's mechanics in our political system that allows the procedure to bring up issues that may be concerned the subject that we're talking about. But I think that the members of the town have a right to proceed in other areas and eliminate the need for us to be a political board. Mm-hmm. I would strongly agree with Tom in that.
Perhaps I could offer a few thoughts on what Tom just finished up with, is that by the nature of what we do, our decisions hopefully then become decisions that are not something which are not merely another step along the line for an applicant, but that our decisions have the backing and the weight of the ordinance of the town behind them, and actually are then have the sort of ability to stand on their own two feet and not be struck down by courts. I think tonight is a good example. We have a public meeting. We have no applicant on the agenda this evening. If a member of the public were to present information relevant to an application without that applicant being there, that opens the possibility of the application, when it is finally decided, being deemed to have not been decided, if you will, to have been pre-decided in a forum where the applicant was not given the right of due process. So I think we are sort of structured in a very deliberate sort of fashion, and we do go out of our way, even though sometimes it is inconvenient for our applicants, to take the extra time and the extra month to bring in public hearings in a good percentage of the applications. I think that, and it bears some mention now, that what we do does not really depend, this has been alluded to, but what we do does not depend on whether we like or dislike the projects. We get a lot of mail. Of course, people will judge projects on their own merits. We can't even hardly do that. We judge projects on whether they fulfill the intent of the town ordinances, or whether they fall short of what's in our town ordinances, and therefore it's not really a process in which the members of this board look for something that would be good for Cape Elizabeth or bad for Cape Elizabeth, something that they like or dislike. And I must admit, having worked only with the planning board, I'm not quite sure how town ordinance committee works, but I'm sure any citizen of the town who thinks that there should be different language in the town center zone ordinance, for instance, there must be some political forum for changes to ordinances. Maybe Maureen, you could explain to us. If someone in town thought, just for instance, that the town center should have a 1,000 square foot footprint limitation instead of a 5,000 square foot limitation, how would this person then pursue that belief and that?
Well, generally, under state law, if you have a land use regulation like a zoning ordinance, it can't be adopted unless the municipal officials hold a public hearing. And if you consider the municipal officials, the town council, you have to hold a public hearing before you adopt an ordinance. So there's built in into the process at the state level requirement for public participation. In addition, there is an opportunity at the town council meetings for anyone to speak to the council. In speaking or writing to the council, there always could be requests for zone change amendments, for text change amendments. The process that we usually use is that the council is not supposed to act on a zoning or subdivision amendment without giving the planning board an opportunity to comment on it. The planning board comment also has to include a public hearing. Then it's forwarded back to the town council. The town council almost always sends any ordinance amendment to its ordinance subcommittee. And that's made up of three town councilors plus the town council chair is an ex officio member. They review the ordinance amendment or new ordinance, and then it's forwarded back to the full town council where, again, they will hold a public hearing. That's generally how the process works.
Thank you. Mr. Emmer.
I think one of the reasons we, and I'm just speaking from the historic experience of having been on the board since about 1990, one of the reasons that public participation or inviting the public to the workshop meeting became so important is the public is extremely frustrated when their first opportunity to speak on a project is at a formal public hearing, after which much of the information has been submitted and already discussed, and the public always felt as though it were behind the eight ball. And to a certain extent, there really is a chicken and an egg problem here, because in order for an applicant to have standing before the board, the applicant has to submit on any sizable project a very extensive amount of information, put together a very expensive application process, easily on larger projects costing $20,000 and $30,000 or more. And at that point, they've come with an application. The application is deemed complete, and then perhaps it's not until the next meeting, or maybe even another meeting after that, that the public hearing might be held. So there's a tremendous amount of information that the applicant has put together before the public gets to stand up at a public forum. So I can clearly understand that frustration. And I think that's why the workshop forum works as well as it does, is because the abutters can come in, or the concerned citizens, and at least see in that forum from the very onset what the project scope is about and what the zoning issues are as they're discussed by the planning board. But short of that, there's no other way in the process of short-circuiting when the public gets up at a formal session of the planning board and is allowed to speak in a public hearing. We have to have a complete application before the board, and if you look at our application checklist, there's just no way of short-cutting that process. There's an awful lot of information that has to be digested by both the planning board and the public at that public hearing.
Let's take this one step further then. Is the public given an opportunity to speak at all your meetings? What should we say?
No.
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 May they speak on every agenda item?
No.
Well, let me ask the question. If there's a, you mean every agenda item that has a public hearing?
No, no, I'm sure this is a blanket form letter that has gone to all town committees.
Well, that's really a two-part question. Are they allowed to speak on every agenda item?
I think we can break this down in our answer.
Eventually.
Well, if you go back to the first one, that's a two-part thing, too.
Yeah, they're also two-part questions.
Public meetings will workshop and public meetings.
Now, my point is, do I have to be in a butter? Do I have to have standing before the planning board in order to get up and speak against a meeting? Or can I, as a citizen of the town of Cape Elizabeth, stand up and at a public hearing?
In fact, the planning board has heard from residents of the city of South Portland on projects that were currently before the board, so you don't even have to be a resident.
So at every meeting where they, at every opportunity where they are able to speak, they are able to speak on those agenda items?
At the public meetings, not the workshops.
At public hearings.
That has been made clear.
Right, at public hearings. Do you estimate times on how long each agenda item will take?
Yes.
I think we...
Right on your agenda.
Yeah. Do we do that at the workshops also?
Yep.
We sort of have an official agenda so that what we're doing is known in advance. Okay? If a member of the public has a concern that is not on your agenda, do you hear the concern, and if so, at which part of the meeting? How should we respond to that?
What you really have to divide it into two parts. Are they speaking about one specific bit of legislation that might be before the committee or something of that sort, or are they speaking just generally about the way we do business or public hearings in general? Obviously, if they're speaking about some specific project and it's not on the agenda and the, let's say the developer isn't present, then clearly we get into some problems there. But if it's just some general comment at the end of the meeting by some person who sat there all night and thinks we're not doing a very good job, then certainly that should be allowed.
So what is the answer to that question?
There isn't. It has to be divided into two parts. The public is entitled to make a general comment, but they may not comment on a specific item of business that is not before the committee that night.
Mm-hmm. One thing that I would like to sort of add into the mix on this is that when we have public hearings, the language in our ordinance says that we entertain public input on matters relating to the application, which one might then construe as having something to do with the physical characteristics of that application or the ordinances under which we're reviewing that application. And we customarily, as a matter of policy, and for as long as I've been here, we let anybody get up and say whatever they want. I have yet to hear somebody be cut off because the person before them said the same thing, or because they're expressing an opinion and not a fact, or whether they're making, you know, whatever sort of statements. Whatever people have to say within the context when we schedule our public hearings is something we listen to. And, you know, it's helpful quite frequently to in the process of reviewing it.
And when do you hear that helpful comment? As you're going along, or do you wait until the end, or do it at the end?
Usually when
How
a public
does it happen?
Yeah, usually when an application has a public hearing, the applicant will make a short presentation, and correct me if I'm wrong, Maureen, before we get into substantive decisions about whether or not the project meets or does not meet the ordinance, the public hearing is then held. all the information from the public hearing is gathered, and then the applicant is given another turn at the podium in order to fill in gaps in the presentation, which happens quite frequently. There are specific things that are raised by the public, specific concerns, and they may not have been highlighted in the application itself, but then the applicant is given the chance to demonstrate how the application deals with whatever those concerns are. And in many cases, you know, they're the same sorts of concerns that we're looking at in terms of the sort of qualitative aspects of how an application relates to the performance standards that we're looking at. But once the public hearing is closed, then the board has the opportunity to discuss and enter into substantive discussion on how we feel what the merits of the application are. We usually don't reopen a public hearing.
However, we have in the past, I think, one.
Have we?
I think the only two times, I think I've been on the board now for 8 years, there have been two times that people have been basically told to cease and desist at the podium. One was for abusive demeanor and potentially abusive language directed at the planning board and by an applicant, and he was gaveled to silence. And there was one time when I was acting chair that I had to ask someone to stop reading poetry at the podium. Those are the only two times that I remember. So I think the public has had free comment for every public meeting that we've had since I've been here.
Well, I think we've touched on all of the aspects here, unless anybody else can think of something that relates that we haven't touched on yet. Yes, Mr.
I think at the heart of the issue here is the fact that we're a small community and we have a local paper that comes out every 2 weeks or so, or twice a month, or whatever the schedule is. The Portland Press Herald will pick up on applications sort of not a hit and miss basis, but you know, if they find one that is real interesting, then they'll cover that. Sometimes there are other news coverage in the area is much more pressing, so and particularly people who like myself that don't have cable TV, that don't have local access, it's very difficult unless one physically comes up here and plunks himself down in a chair and constantly monitors the posted agendas and is also on the internet. There is a lot of work to staying informed and staying up with projects, and I think probably the thing that the public fears the most is this sense that things are happening without their knowledge or behind their back. And time passes fairly quickly. What seems to have happened behind one's back, like the zoning reordinate, not that the zoning rewrite happened behind anyone's back, but it may appear to be such that because people have really don't know that this thing was two and a half years in the making, it may seem that it came down to the last town council meeting that the vote was yes, and gee, what do you know, overnight they passed the ordinance. So I think that's probably a source of frustration in terms of public input.
I'm not sure that people are aware of the fact that we meet twice a month and there are no subcommittee meetings, there are no afternoon work sessions, there's nothing but our two bi-monthly
and occasional site walks.
And the occasional site walks. So I'm not sure everybody's aware of the sort of the information on an application that's presented to the public is all, that's all there is. What the public gets to see and what we see are in fact the same thing.
And lastly, at least from my standpoint, one of the most heart-wrenching things is to read editorials in the paper and again the correspondence we get and understanding the emotional and sentimental issues that are being expressed in those articles, but they're not consistent with the group of town citizens that met for many, many months or years and developed the comprehensive plan, and then the years that it took to put that into zoning ordinances and the meetings and countless meetings. So I think one of the best ways for the public to be involved in the planning board, so to speak, other than sitting on the board, is to become involved at the very onset of the comprehensive development of the comprehensive plan and then staying in touch with the evolution of the zoning language and staying familiar with that.
Just perhaps in closing, that reminds me, one of the things that I've noticed in terms of what one likes or feels good or is bad or has merit or not comes through in the ordinances. And interestingly enough, and this is something we notice from time to time, the planning board is really on the tail end of the ordinance procedure in the town. As many times as not, ordinances that deal with planning really are not generated by planning staff or planning board or zoning board. They are generated through the forum where people decide what they like and don't like, and it comes to us to interpret and enforce them, sort of at the tail end of the procedure. And citizen involvement in the actual process of governing this town has more to do with what ends up in the ordinances and therefore in the final analysis ends up in the ground here than I think people realize. With that, is there anything else regarding our citizen participation agenda item, which needs to be added into the equation here? I think at this point we've given Maureen enough directive on our last paragraph to frame a response.
So you're going to basically put together a new memorandum, which we will have then for the next public meeting?
On this discussion?
Yep.
We don't need to do that. If you want to do that, we can. One way we can respond is we just can transcribe the minutes of this discussion.
Okay, and then just send it along.
And then just send it along.
I'd like to make a motion.
Mr. Parker, please make a motion.
That we make a motion to adjourn the meeting.
Do I hear a second? The motion is seconded. All those in favor? Raise your right hand. Meeting adjourned.
I know.
Thank you.